I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end, he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh, I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound. The dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. Then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Then I heard a voice from heaven say, write this. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit. They will rest from their labor, for their deeds will follow them. Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to pay our final tribute of respect to that which was mortal of our deceased loved one and friend, Marcia Kathleen Austin. To you members of the family who mourn your loss, we especially offer you our deep condolences and sincere sympathy. May we share with you the comfort afforded by God's word for such a time as this. And this is what the word of God says. It says, do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. The word of God also says, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, Jesus, will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, from whom we come and to whom we go, grant us the favor of your divine presence at this time. Lord, assure us by your Spirit that the one we serve, even Jesus, has conquered death and is alive forevermore. Lord, enable us to view our temporal lives in light of the eternal. And so may our spirits grow calm and our vision clear. Through Christ we pray. Amen and amen. Please remain standing as we worship God in song. Thank you.
for him through all the changing scenes of life. Through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy, the praises of my Lord shall fill my heart and darling glory. Bible reading is taken from St. John's Gospel, chapter 14, reading from verse 2 through verse 6. It will be read by Angelina Boxill, and it's from the New King James Version.
Reading is taken from John 14, 2 to 6. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Here ends the reading.
I'd like to acknowledge the presence of the Right Honorable Frondell Stewart, former Prime Minister, Mr. Steve Blackett, Mr. Michael Carrington, Mr. Richard Seeley, Dr. David Estwick, and Mr. John Boyce. Thanks for attending on behalf of the family. I'm sure they're appreciative of your, not only your presence, but your support. I now invite Miss Lisa Hackett, who will pay a tribute in song.
Good afternoon. The title of my solo is Goodbye is the Saddest Word, and is a dedication from her daughter, Kishelle. I hope you find comfort in this song, and may her sweet soul rest in peace. Break
my heart to hear you say goodbye.
Peace, Marcia.
We'll now have an appreciation by Kishelle Brathwaite and Julie Austin.
Pastor, family, friends, the LP family, and others. Marcia Kathleen Austin, known to her nephews as Marmar and to her grandson as Marcia, was born on November 24, 1954, to Sheila Austin and the late Colin Flossie Phillips of the UK. She was the first of her mother's children, sister to Ephemy, Charles, Julie Herfrago, and baby sister to late Clifford Marshall and Colin Hope. Loving mother to Kishelle and cherished grandmother to Caden, her KK. Marcia grew up in Grants Gap, Westbury Road, St. Michael, and attended the Westbury Primary School and then the St. Leonard's Girls School, formerly Richmond. After leaving school, she worked at the Carly Laboratories, Barbados Hardware, Fawcett, and R.E. Branca. She was also the constituency assistant for St. Michael West to the late Sir Branford Tate. Her last job before retiring in 2021 was at Munford Chambers. Marcia loved to dress up and would wear the highest heels you can think about. She would spend hours in front of the mirror putting on her makeup with her red lipstick. If it wasn't red, it wasn't Marcia. She was a slim thing back in the day. She would dress up and make up her face, even if it was only to going in the next gap by her godmother, Miss Sharpness. In the 70s, the Nation newspaper hosted a beauty competition, and she entered. She was crowned Miss Sunshine. She was in the newspaper for a good few days, and she let everyone know that she was Miss Sunshine. She had a great love for gardening and ceramics. She loved the color pink. Our wearing pink today is a tribute to her. Marcia joined the Democratic Labor Party in 1977 and was branch secretary, chairman, treasurer, floor member to the St. Michael West branch. She also served as the party's highest body, the General Council and the Executive Council. Talk about detailed minutes. Anyone reading months after will feel that they were now at the meeting. As constituency assistant, she was respected by many in St. Michael West, from Hines Bay Road to Deacon's Road. They had different names for her, Miss Marcia, Miss Austin, Boss Lady. To this day, I could still hear persons saying, Miss Marcia got them a job, or she helped them apply for their pension, or fill out or sign a passport form for them. She assisted them in so many ways. That was my sister. She was one of the longest constituency assistants in the Democratic Labor Party. She was a stalwart and a loyal Dem. Her DLP passport was like her ID card, always in her handbag. And I think she helped wrote the party's constitution because she knew it all and would correct and challenge you on it. I remember her and the late David Thompson at a branch meeting, telling him, you are the guest speaker. You can't come and take over this meeting. When it's your time to speak, we will introduce you. You could risk that in any other constituency, but not in St. Michael West. The late Sir Bramford Tate said to her, but Marcia, that is the chairman, that is the president. And she replied, and I am the chairman of this branch. That was her friend. And you dare not say anything about him. That was my sister. My mom said she misses Marcia dearly. As we would say, she is her favorite. She remember after she came out of the hospital, after giving birth to me, I had to go back into hospital. Marcia told her that she would look after me, not knowing that she meant until I became a young lady. Well, up to that sad day, she was still looking after me.
Every day, sometimes three and four times, and when everyone is sleeping, Gran and Marcia will still be up all after one on the phone talking, and then you would hear Gran saying, wait, Marcia gone sleep on me and snoring too, and got me on the phone talking. She said she would miss their daily conversations with her firstborn, and with tears in her eyes and a crackle in her voice, she said no mother wants to bury their children. As a child growing up, my Aunt Eve May remembered my mom and Uncle Charles and Uncle Charles and her going to the exhibition in Queen's Park, all dressed up in their can-can dresses and white shoes and socks. With frills and Charles in his finest. He was always an outstanding dresser. What she remembered most after the exhibition, they would go to Jeff Ice Cream Parlor for ice cream. Our grandfather could never understand why everyone was laughing until he looked and saw Marcia blowing away on the ice cream. He asked her why she was blowing it. She said, it had steam coming from it. Everyone in the parlor laughed. My Uncle Charles remembers the love they have for each other. She never called him Pastor. It was always Charles. He said what stands out most was the morning he went to look for her and she hugged him and told him she loved him, and not knowing that would be the last time he would hear from her, he would hear her calling his name. He said that every evening his sister would... He said that that same evening his sister was gone and all he could do was kiss her and tell her he would always love her. What I remember most about my mother is not being able to leave home without her. She would see me getting dressed and she would get dressed also or ask, where are you going? I could go for the drive, guarantee, before I could answer, she would be hustling to get dressed to go through the door with me. I remember taking care to lessons on Sundays and we would find a beach to park and wait until lessons was over. For the next 2 hours, we would sit and talk some of everything, and she would fall asleep on me like always. Or some Friday nights, going to her favorite spot in Eden Lodge to buy her ribs and salad. I remember when I found out I was pregnant with Caden, I was scared to tell my mother. After my first visit to the doctor, I wrote it on a piece of paper and took it to her work and gave her it, and through the door I went. Then my phone rang, it was her. She said, Key, what you wrote on this paper is true? I said, yes. I heard nothing else from her, but I could hear the smile through the phone. From that day, once my mother went town or anywhere that sells baby stuff, guaranteed she would buy something to bring home. After Caden was born, he became her newfound love, her heart, as she would constantly tell him. Everyone she met had to know she was a grandmother and all about her KK. She never missed any milestones in his life, and I never thought that when he went to his investiture into Scouts back in July this year, that would be the last milestone she would ever get to spend with him. Caden remembers most laying in bed with his Marcia, as he would call her, and having their many conversations, and her rubbing his foot. When she would cook his favorite meals, brown down with potato and lamb or soup with lots of dumplings. They prayed together, they sang together, and made jokes about me together. There were two peas in a pod, and each other's protector. When she was in the hospital, Caden went into a quiet mode, hardly talking to anyone, and would always ask for his Marcia. When the day finally came and he got to visit her, when she looked around and saw him, her face lit up just like the Christmas lights that she would always put up every year for him. They made sure to let each other know how much they miss and love each other, and the whole world knew as well, as he could only stand by the door. I will miss you calling my name 100 times in a day. I will miss you asking Key, what are we eating today? I will miss us leaving home to go one place and end up all over. I will miss you asking, breakfast done yet? KK and me hungry. I will miss you coming in my bedroom. I can't get up in the bed because it was too high, so you would just sit at the end. I want to thank you for being one of the best grandmothers ever and giving care and the memories we will always cherish. Her special friend Winslow, Mr. Carbs, as Caden would call him, enjoyed when she visited in 2019 prior to the COVID lockdown. He was looking forward to seeing her again shortly. Winslow, I know you miss hearing her voice, and I am sorry you can't be here with us today. She will always be with you in spirit. Jim said his most memorable and enjoyable moments with her was as a child, and especially around Christmas time, he would wait for her like a kid waits for Santa to drop off his presents, and he will miss the long conversations they had when he became an adult. She and her cousin Cheryl were like twins, born a day apart, Marcia on the 24th and she on the 25th of November 1954. They spoke on the phone every day, 2 and 3 times a day. She said, in her opinion, Marcia's strongest trait was her boundless sense of loyalty. When she was your friend, she was your friend. No questions asked. She was a true and loving and loyal person.
She was not only my sister, but my mother, my confidant, my fraggle. My can't tell anything to. My sister meant the world to me, and I could tell my sister anything and everything. She had the same. She can do the same. The love we shared was unbelievable. Growing up, every Sunday, my sister would dress me and my late cousin Andrea, who died 2 weeks before her. She would take us to Esso Spring Garden just to take pictures by the anchor, and then for ice cream at Chefet. She and her friend Tom would take us to watch some music at the Globe Cinema. You name it, my sister would take me. I was the daughter she didn't have at the time. To this day, many people still think she's my mother. When she got pregnant with Keshel, my sister disliked me. I could never understand why she would shout at me for no reason. When I came home from school, I had to stay outside even though I had a key. She would be inside and would bolt the door. She would open the door at 4 o'clock because she knew mommy was almost home. She would often catch the cramp in both feet and no one could get the cramp out. I would watch mommy and Leroy rub and rub and rub. The more they rubbed, the more she would cry. Until one day, Leroy asked me to come and rub her feet. I rubbed her feet and the cramp stopped in one. And every evening, she would catch the cramp around 5 o'clock. And I would go outside and play, and she would cry and cry. And until I feel she cried enough, I would come back in. When Keshel was born, she was everything of me. And the bond we had went back to how it was before. My sister introduced me to politics and took me to political meetings. And everyone knew I was her little sister. You name it, I was with her. My sons Dario and Rashad were her everything. They called her Mama or Auntie. And she called Dario Dada and Rashad Shadipo. But only she can call them by those names. She loved all her nieces and nephews and cousins. Terry, Shane, Atora, Trasani, Shamani, Ariel, Tarina, Tiana, Larissa, Renako, Alyssa, Azara, all of them. She played a significant role in their lives. And her two godsons, Morris and the late Omar, they can now have their morning chats like old times. Just like me, she had love for our cousin Andrea. As fate would have it, she died suddenly on a Saturday after 6 a.m. She died suddenly on a Saturday after 6 p.m. His postmortem was a Tuesday. Hers was a Tuesday also. His funeral was a Thursday. Today we're here celebrating the life. His funeral ended at 1:30. Hers began at 1:30. The bond between them live on.
Even in death. Marcia,
Marmar,
Marcia, Mummy, Auntie,
Fraggle, Godmummy.
You will always remain in our hearts, and we will continue to love you. The words from one of her favorite songs, Grant Morgan.
If you give a little more than you take, if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place in heaven for people like you. Thank you.
Michelle and Julie, thanks for giving us a glimpse into Marcia's life. May your pleasant memories be a source of support during this difficult season. I invite Kalia Hardin to pay tribute. The second Bible reading is taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, 1 to 11, read by Roger Abram from the New International Version.
Good afternoon, everyone. This second Bible reading is taken from Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 to 11. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What do workers gain from their toils? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has set eternity in the human's heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. There ends the reading.
I acknowledge the presence of Mr. James Paul and Mr. Stephen Lashley. Thanks for coming out to support the family. Kindly stand with me as we sing the hymn, Blessed Assurance.
Blessed Assurance. Oh,
Amen. Blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. I also acknowledge the presence of Mr. William Chandler, High Court Judge, who's Marcia's cousin. Thank you, sir, for sharing with us this evening. I invite our assistant pastor, Dr. Lindsay Arthur, to come and deliver the homily. Kindly remain standing as Dr. Arthur comes.
Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Father, this is your word. I know now, Lord, that you sense the grief, the mourning that exists in this sanctuary. Father, this family and these friends have come to pay a tribute to the life of Marcia, Kathleen Austin. And they're missing her. This room, Lord, is filled with memories of her. This is a celebration of the life of someone who clearly has made an impact on humanity. Father, I pray that this word will in some way meet its mark. I ask you to do what I certainly cannot, to search these hearts, provide comfort to them. In the name of Jesus, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Usually when I speak on occasions like this, I am reminded that people don't usually come to hear the person who is giving the homily. It's usually a very difficult time and our thoughts are roaming all over. But nevertheless, this is the way that I believe Marcia would have it, that she would want us to sit for a while and reflect on God's word. I promise not to make it long, but I am trusting God that he will get through to us today as he speaks to us. They say that there are two things in life that are certain. One, two. They say that two things in life are certain. And one is taxes. We are sure to be taxed. Know what I say? We are sure to be taxed. And the other one is death. Two sure things in life. But the thing is, though, that even with taxes are not always certain. Because if you're rich enough, you can hire a tax professional to help you reduce your taxes so that you pay little tax or no tax at all. And in fact, the super wealthy, if you're really, really wealthy, you can change your residency. Or you can move some of your wealth to a low tax jurisdiction to reduce your tax. So what this means is that the payment of tax, while the levying of tax is certain the payment of tax is not always as certain. It can be avoided. Death, on the other hand, is certain. It cannot be avoided. Each one of us here today, every last one of us, great and small, big and tall, male and female, every last one of us here today will at some point in time experience death. You know, from the beginning of time, human beings have fixated on the avoidance of death. Even although we know that we can't avoid it, we fixated on it in trying to see how we can at least push it off. Doctors and scientists will tell you that there are ways that we can live longer. And usually these ways involve things like healthy lifestyle. You know, getting some more exercise and so on, giving up certain habits, smoking and the high consumption of alcohol and so on and so forth. They will tell us that. Ancient folklore, too, has suggested various ways to avoid death, including, among other things, never placing a broom on the bed. Never sweeping the house after sundown. Keeping cats off piano keys. Never rocking an empty rocking chair. Never moving into an unfinished house. Folklore says that if you want to avoid death, that you must do those things. However, death persists. And I've come to realize that the biggest problem in life is not death itself, but it is the way that we live our lives in light of the certainty of death. That's the real issue. Human beings in grappling with the certainty of death have adopted one of two approaches to life. We do one of two things, generally speaking. One approach is to live life as if there's no death. Just ignore it. So in other words, we know that death is real, but we pretend that it doesn't exist in the hope that we will not experience it. Such persons like that, will never utter the words death or dying. Instead, they would prefer to use such terms as decease, eternal rest, perhaps even eternal sleep, or passing. Someone has passed. They haven't died, they've passed, or they've passed away. And this is how we cope with the idea of death. Because we know that death is not our friend. It will never be. But we do our best to cope with it. And persons like that prefer not to speak about things that might, in their mind, precipitate death. So they will never talk, or they will never be good conversation partners while flying on a plane, for example. You know, there are some people who, when they go on a plane and they're flying and there's the thought or the fear of dying, they never talk. And they also never speak about things that approximate death, like serious long-term illness. You know, this approach to life, however, is tantamount to living life in the present only, as if death is the end of life. That is, we live our lives based on what we can see now, how we feel now, and what we want now. This approach to life assumes that nothing exists after this earthly life. It assumes that. So, in the belief that we only have one life to live, what do? We live this life and we enjoy it to the fullest. I'm sure no one here today certainly adopts this approach to life. But many people do. Jesus tells us about a parable in the Gospel of Luke. And it's a parable that in part describes this approach to life. Jesus says that there was a man who had two sons. And the younger of the two sons asked for his share of the family estate. Said, "Daddy, I want what is mine." And the father reluctantly honors the request of the son, who not many days later gathered his possessions in his little Georgie bundle, and he went to live in a distant country, got away as far as possible from Daddy. And the parable goes that while he was there, he squandered his share of the father's estate, enjoying life. So in other words, he lived in the present only, during which time he satisfied his desires only. For him, there was no tomorrow. There was no need to put aside anything for a rainy day. He didn't consider that he might become sick. Sick? What's that? Didn't consider that he might have need to dip into a little reserve fund to get himself through a difficult time. No, he spent everything. In Beijing, we would say he licked it out. And he became so poor that he had to hire himself out to a pig farmer to feed swine. And while he was feeding the swine, he was beginning to harbor some thoughts about how nice the pig food was looking. Well, some people adopt this approach to living despite or in spite of the certainty of death. They live now, for now, and not consider tomorrow. This approach to life, right? It's like taking out a loan, knowing that at the end of the month, an installment must be paid. But we pretend either that time will never come, meaning the end of month will never come, it will never happen, or that when it comes, we can ignore the need to pay that installment. In so doing, we hope, against all hopes, that our lender might overlook our loan account. In other words, the books would disappear, and the loan would disappear, and they wouldn't remember that we owe them. That approach to life is like doing that. That approach to living treats life as if the certainty of death is unreal. It will never happen to me. I don't have to think about it. However, there's another approach to living this life in light of the certainty of death. That is, we live it accepting the reality of human death and making plans now to be on the right side of eternity. The truth is that ignoring death, ignoring the reality of it, doesn't make death and the consequences of death go away. The Apostle Paul provides a clear explanation of this reality in his second letter to the Corinthians. And there, he explains something that goes like this, and I'm going to paraphrase it. He said that when our physical bodies, which he describes as earthly tents, it's a tent because you know that a tent is temporal, it's temporary. So he says, when our physical bodies, which he describes as earthly tents, are torn down by death, we look forward to resurrected bodies that are the eternal buildings of God, houses not made with hands. Paul contrasts temporary tents of our human bodies with the permanent buildings of our resurrected or heavenly bodies. You see, for Paul, if you are a Christian disciple, you long to be clothed in your resurrected or heavenly body. Because having put it on, according to Paul, you will not be found naked. If you're a Christian disciple, you recognize that while you presently reside in our human body, you are absent from the presence of God. Paul says that he would rather be absent from this earthly body. In other words, he is saying that he would rather die in the physical sense, because he knows that when he dies in the physical sense, he is at home, or he is present with the Lord forever. That's what he says. Paul wants to please God in this life as well as in death. And he hopes to hear in death, he hopes that at the end, he hopes to hear Jesus' welcome. That goes something like this: come, you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For Paul, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. So death loses its sting. By this, he means that if he lives on in the flesh, he has the pleasure of living on for Christ. Living on for Christ and serving Christ. However, if he departs, or when he departs, he will be with Christ, which for him is much better. Paul believes, and I believe too, that we, every last one of us, will and must appear before the judgment seat of Christ and give account of our deeds in the flesh. Everything that we have done, whether good or bad. This is the word of God. Let me say that again. We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ and give account of our deeds in the flesh, whether good or bad. Therefore, we must understand that while death means the end of our human life, after physical death comes eternity. The writer to the Hebrews, the letter to the Hebrews, confirms this truth, saying that just as people are destined to die once, just as people are destined to die once, and after that face the judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many. And he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. I put it to you today that this is the preferred approach to living this life in view of the certainty of death. I thank God. I truly thank Him that our departed sister, Marcia Kathleen Austin, has been the beneficiary of God's seeking grace. You see, God seeks every one of us. He pursues us relentlessly. Even when we are not looking, God is pursuing us, nudging us, talking to us, persuading us, or attempting to do so, causing circumstances to come into our lives whereby we must stop and think and reflect and consider the possibility of change. I thank God that He has sought, or that He has extended His seeking grace to Marcia Kathleen Austin. I understand that Marcia Kathleen devoted her life to family and service. She was a justice of the peace, which made her a judicial officer appointed by means of commission to keep the peace. She served her community as a constituency assistant to a former member of parliament. She served people. I bet you that she loved people, because to serve people, we have to love people. She was adored by her family. She was adored by her family as a daughter, a mother, biological and adoptive. She was a spouse, grandmother, sister, aunt, great aunt, cousin, godmother. She was a sister-in-law. She was a relative. She was a friend. I've never had the pleasure of meeting face-to-face Marcia Kathleen. But from the testimonies about her, I believe that she was cherished and she will be missed by her family and by her community. I want to assure you, family and friends, that we here at Western Light Church of the Nazarene, we want to express our sincere condolences to Marcia's family. We know that you are going to grieve her loss. There will be a time when there's an unfilled seat at the dinner table. However, we pray that God will grant you His grace and peace throughout your period of mourning, however long it lasts. And we trust that as you mourn, you will look to God. If you have never looked to Him, consider using this as an opportunity to look to Him to heal your pain and your hurt. We commend you to God's care and keeping for that healing to begin. Amen and amen. It falls upon me at this time to offer a prayer for the family of Kathleen, Marcia Kathleen. And in offering this prayer, I'm basically, we are asking God to help you during this time of mourning. Help you to, help us to get through it. That's what it's about. So whether you're a family member, an immediate family member, a distant family member, or whether you're a close friend, if you are mourning Marcia Catherine's loss, I'm going to ask you to stand where you are. You don't have to move anywhere. Just stand as a sign that you're going to identify yourself as a family member or a friend of Kathleen that's mourning. You know, it's not shameful to mourn, you know. Jesus says that blessed are they that mourn. The thing is that we mourn because we don't know what to do with death. No one has figured it out. But we experience separation. And we try to find meaning. Oh dear God, Almighty God, you, Lord, are aware of the intense sorrow caused by the death of our loved one. And Father, in your eternal wisdom, you ask us to cast our cares on you. You tell us to tell you our deepest concerns. And Father, today we come to you to tell you that we are grieving and we are hurting. We are missing Marcia Kathleen. And you also let us know, Lord, that your spirit intercedes for us with groanings and that words cannot explain and express. But Father, we come not claiming that we understand everything, because indeed we don't. But we come to you. I pray, God, that you would settle the hearts of every mourner here today. I pray, Lord, that you will comfort and strengthen their hearts for the journey ahead without Marcia Kathleen. Father, you are Yahweh Shalom. The Lord is peace. And I pray that you would bring your peace, your true peace, to rest on these hearts today, in the next few days, in the weeks and months and years ahead. I pray too, Lord, that you would refresh their minds. So that they will look to you as they grieve. And Lord, when the grief becomes a little too much to bear, they will reach out to someone around them. And I pray, Father, that you would provide a strong person for them to lean on as they mourn. Father, we pray that you'll continue to provide your abundant grace to each family member individually. May each one look to you for the answer. Heavenly Father, fulfill your will in their lives. We ask these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, trusting in him and in your gift of him to humanity to save us from sin. We thank you for how you will respond to us, Lord. Amen and amen. Bless God. Please remain standing as we now have the recessional hymn, and Sister Cicely will come and lead us in that hymn.
We have a change in the program, Pastor. We received a tribute from Kalia Harding. We had announced it earlier. It's a video tribute, and Kalia resides overseas, so I direct your attention to the monitors. After that, we'll have the recessional hymn.
Good afternoon. I want to thank everyone for coming today. My name is Kalia Harding, and Marcia was like a mother to me. Dear Mama, I am still hoping this is all a dream. I had no idea I'd have to live without you so soon. My heart can't take it. You are my person, such a pure and kind-hearted woman. You would do anything to ensure I was happy. I'm going to miss seeing you put on your red lipstick and face powder. I'm going to miss helping you take out your curlers, and I'm going to miss helping you water your plants. When Christmas is coming up, you usually call me and tell me to come and help you clean. We would clean everywhere. No matter how much older or how much bigger I've gotten, you would want me to get on top the counters and clean on top the shelves and up top the fridge. We had a great relationship. Anytime I wanted to know how to cut anything, I'd call you and you'd tell me exactly what to do. I would massage your foot and you would complain about how much cream I wasted. I wish I could hear you right now telling me to turn on the television because you're on the phone, or to switch the channel to CBC because you wanted to watch the news at 7. I miss you so much, Mama. When I would go by your office on the evening after school, you were so excited and happy to see me. I miss you so much. The last memory I had with you, I was going away. And you wanted to see me for the last. I know that you wanted to see me for the last. So you came, although I told you I had a drop already to the airport, you still came. And you hugged me. And before you left, you was crying. You told me how much you loved me and that you wished me the best. And that was so special to me. And I don't feel like I could be the person I am today without you. I love you so much. And I hope you know how much you are loved and missed. And I know in a time like this, you will tell me to trust the Lord. And you will tell me to just pray. So that's what I'm going to do. Thank you.
The family has requested that the casket be reopened so that those individuals who were unable to view may do so during this time. I'll ask the ushers to get in place to ensure that this is done orderly. You may remain seated and I will indicate when I want you to stand. Thank you.
Can it be that I should gain an interest?
me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We gather now to commit to this resting place the body of Marcia Kathleen Austin, whose spirit has already entered into eternity. This spot of earth will hold the form of her body. But we know that it is appointed for men to die once, and after this comes judgment. And we know that we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his or her deeds in the body, according to what he or she has done, whether good or bad. Therefore, with these truths in mind, let us who remain walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which we have been called. No longer like the crowd and the futility of their mind, but let us walk in love as children of light and as wise men and women. Let us pray. Eternal God, from whom we come and to whom we go, grant us the favor of your divine presence at this time in our earthly pilgrimage. Father, assure us by your Spirit that the one whom we serve, Jesus Christ, has conquered death and is alive forevermore. Help us to view this or these our temporal lives in light of the eternal. And so may our spirits grow calm and our vision clear. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. For as much as it pleased Almighty God, in his wise providence, to take out of this world the soul of our departed Marcia Kathleen, we commit her mortal body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Her spirit we leave with God, for we know the merciful judge of all the earth will do right. Let us who remain dedicate ourselves anew to live in the fear and love of God, so that we may obtain an abundant entrance into the heavenly kingdom. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God of all mercy, we look to you in this moment of sorrow and bereavement. Father, we ask you to comfort these dear ones whose hearts are heavy and sad. Will you be with them, Lord? Sustain them and guide them in the days to come. Grant, O Lord, that they may love and serve you and obtain the fullness of your promises in the world to come. Amen and amen.
neck bleed.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
That.
Memories bring back, memories bring back.
If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you.
Let's sing that hymn, I'll Fly Away. Some glad morning, when this life is o'er, I'll fly away. To home on God's celestial shore, I'll fly away.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. It is well with my soul. I understand that this is a family favorite. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, you have taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Anchor hold in the storms of life. When the clouds unfold their wings of strife, when strong tides lift and the cables strain, will your anchor drift or firm remain? Will your anchor hold? Storms of life. clouds unfold their wings of strife. When the strong tides lift and the cables strain, will your anchor drift or firm remain? We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. If 'tis safely moored, 'twill the storm withstand, for 'tis well secured by the Savior's hand. And the cables passed from his heart to thine can defy the blast through strength divine. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure will the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. It will firmly hold in the straits of fear when the breakers tell that the reef is near. Though the tempest rave and the wild winds blow, not an angry wave shall or bark or flow. We have an anchor that keeps us so steadfast and sure will the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. It will surely hold in the floods of dearth when the waters chill or late his breath. On the rising tide it can never fail while our hope abide within the veil. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. Last verse. When our eyes behold in the dawning light shining gates of pearl or harbor bright, we shall anchor fast to the heavenly shore. Will the storms all pass forevermore? We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. Praise the Lord. Another family favorite, love lifted me. I was sinking deep in sin, sinking to rise no more, overwhelmed by guilt within. Mercy I did implore. Then the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. Christ my Savior lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me.
Sinking deep in sin, sinking to rise no more, overwhelmed, deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. Then the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. Christ, the waters lifted.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions bright and blessed. He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all get to heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace in the
final hymn is, I am free. Don't grieve for me, for now I'm free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard him call. I turned my back and left it all. I'm free.
Charles.
I could not stay another day to laugh, to love, to work or play. Tasks left undone must stay that way. I found that peace at the close of day. What lovely words. Dear friends, we've laid to rest the body of Marcia Kathleen. Now we pray for God's blessing and guidance as we leave this place. Let us pray. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The grace of God, our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forevermore. Amen. May God bless you, and you go in peace.